the chair of humanity. I welcome all of you to the twin oration. And I also sincerely apologize for the delay in beginning the same. I will now request the dignitaries to please come onto the dais. The first oration is the Dr. Ram Prabhu oration, and we have Dr. Ram Prabhu amongst us. So I now request Dr. Ram Prabhu to please come onto the dais. I will now request our distinguished orator for the oration, Dr. Nicholas Antoff, to please come onto the dais. I now request our chairpersons, our very dear Dr. Lopa Mehta and Dr. Director and Dean Dr. Avinash will join us in a few minutes. I now request Dr. Sandhya Kamath, who is the Joint Secretary of the Government Alumni Association, to welcome the dignitaries of the dais with a small token of our appreciation. A floral tribute, Dr. Nicholas Antoff, please. Dr. Lopa Mehta, ma'am. And Dr. S.P. Srivastava. It is indeed an honor and a privilege to introduce his oration to all of you. Dr. Ram Prabhu completed his MBBS and MS also in the year 1981 from these very same institute. He undertook advanced training in spinal trauma in Germany and France under distinguished professors. He later completed many fellowships in Germany, France, Hong Kong and USA, especially in relation to trauma, spine, arthroscopy and joints. He has delivered multiple lectures and orations and participated in various symposia both nationally and internationally. Dr. Prabhu sir has held more than 200 workshops and taught more than 5,500 orthopedic surgeons all over the country and abroad. He was the organizing chairman of multiple conferences held both nationally as well as internationally. He has held 10 national and 4 international conferences on his own. He is the organizing secretary for the Golden Jubilee IOCON 2005 Mumbai and many more subsequently after that. Sir has and is holding many prestigious positions in national and international professional bodies. He is a trustee of the JES Research and Development Society. He has co-authored 4 books, and not just that, 2 of those have been awarded the best book award from the Bombay Orthopedic Society. So I think it's one is on trauma management and the other is on ultrasonography of shoulder. He has been the past course director of MCH Specials and past convener of basic surgical skills for FRCS Edinburgh. Working on deformity correction and development currently of newer and inexpensive indigenous techniques in orthopedics, not just that. He also has hobbies, which include mountaineering. He's gone to Himalayas and Alps 20 times. He's very fond of music. He's especially fond of organizing events and one such thing is this. And he's fond of making friends. So all those who are interested, please communicate with him. You can take his email as from us or from Sarna. His wife, Meena, is a gynecologist and she's the director of Mukund Hospital. His sons are doing orthopedic surgery, not unexpected. Fellow in spine, Asi and Anuj, and the other one is a banker in USA. Currently, I think sir is the head of the department at DN Desai Hospital and has been heading that department since the last 25 years. He is a medical director of Mukund Hospital and a consultant at Kina Nandani Hospital. So with these few words, I would now request the chairperson. He is the president of Orthopedic Indian Orthopedic Society since 2017. Okay. I'm sorry for that. I would now request Professor S.K. Srivastava to introduce the chair speaker for the day.
A very good afternoon to all of you, respected dignitary and dear colleagues and my dear students. You know what is the purpose of this whole meeting? There is a single purpose behind all these things. And the purpose is that you should know your alumnus. Each one of them, they are visiting nowadays. They are actually moved to see the growth, further growth in different departments. And they want to participate into it. So you must know your alumni, that is one. And second, to palpate within you that even the sky is not the limit to cross. So this is just to stimulate the younger generation. It is my proud privilege to welcome Dr. Antao in his own alma mater, and he is going to deliver a talk, not in orthopedics, but you see, even his topic for the talk is different. It is nothing to do with the orthopedics. And we know it is not only orthopedic which is important. First, one should be a proper and good human being. And that is, I think, the foremost criteria to even choose your branch, and that is medicine. So this is very important. I am really happy that Dr. Antao, you have chosen this topic. He is very near and dear to me. And it is really my honor to tell about him today. It is here. I have been knowing him since last 25 years. A very kind and gentle person. And even if you have any trouble, whether it is related to patients or any other thing, he always stands behind you. And it is not only Ram Prabhu, most of these alumni, they are always with you, and that's why Madam told you, you have their contact number and email ID. And Ram Prabhu, whatever the description was there, that was a paragraph. The way he works for the younger generation, it is just unparalleled. And you should take advantage of all these people who are ready to help you. So for your career, for your well-being, all these people are there. So the purpose of this program is to you know your alumni. This is very important. Shortened out ultimately, the youngest one in this crowd. So this is happening, and then you have an extra locus in your gene which we are lacking, and you have got significant good mutation in your genes. So now again sorted out. So I welcome Dr. Ram Prabhu and Dr. Antao, and other alumni are also sitting here. I welcome all of you here, and it is my proud privilege to introduce this year Ram Prabhu Orekar, and he is our dear Dr. Nicholas Antao. A big applause for him today. So the most important thing for us about his introduction is that he is alumnus of this very same institute. And I think he must be going through the memory lane, studying anatomy, physiology in this very lecture hall. So welcome to you, to this hall. He was also assistant professor in Department of Orthopedics here. He was professor and HOD of multiple, institutions, and at present heading professor and HOD of Orthopedics at Holy Spirit Hospital. Past president of Bombay Orthopedic Society, and he headed this society in 2008 and 9. He was president of Indian Orthopedic Society and editor of many journals. Whenever we have any publication issue in BOS, we always look towards him, because he is master in that. Not only in our local, even in the national level, he has done fantastic job. He was editor of Indian Orthopedic Society newsletter, Indian Federation of Medical Guilds Journal, Bombay Orthopedic Society, Ortho Front newsletter, and very sincere to see that each issues come in time. With a very good continuation of all these things, then Journal of Clinical Orthopedic and Research, the official Index Journal of DOS. Many publications he has to his credit in international and national journals, has contributed chapters in several orthopedic textbooks, has organized several national as well as international level conferences, and is the chairman of PMAC Biomedical Ethics Center. He is a sports person also. And you can think what care he might be taking for all these legendary, you know, sportsmen. So he is having an extra distinction about this. And he is going to talk on Illuminate Your Being. I welcome and request him to kindly deliver this oration. Dr. Nicholas Sandoz.
Very good afternoon. Our Dean Dr. Avinash Chupe, there you are. Dr. Rupa Mehta, Dr. Srivastava, Dr. Ram Prabhu, Mrs. Prabhu, professors, friends, and my young future doctors of the cosmic community. I am very grateful to cosmic alumni and consider it as a great opportunity and honor and proud privilege to be the first orator for the Dr. Ram Prabhu Oration. When I asked Dr. Ram Prabhu, what should I say about him? You know what he said? Don't say anything. But only say that I am alive and kicking. And this is exactly what epitomizes Dr. Ram Prabhu. His aliveness and humanity. To his patients, Dr. Ram Prabhu is really like a problem, because they not go to him for only their physical ailments, but also seek his advice in matters of social, economic and emotional issues. They are always happy and grateful for his help and cooperation. To his friends and colleagues, he is a friend, philosopher and guide. They often seek his advice and counsel and never return ill-advised and dissatisfied. Dr. Ram Prabhu is a multifaceted personality, a born leader, a mentor and a motivator. He is always available when you want him, and equally share in your joy, despair, in your happiness and sorrow. Among many qualities and talents of Dr. Ram Prabhu, one that stands out very uniquely is his ability to mobilize resources, especially at critical times. He is always in the forefront of giving his help and mobilizing resources in natural calamities and disasters. Ram has a vision and is meticulous in his planning. May it be to organize a conference or foster and encourage the growth of a society or organization. And no wonder he has been the president of so many academic, medical and social organizations. You have heard that he had single-handedly done over 200 Yes Fixed workshops, not only in India but all over the world. As a president of the Indian Orthopedic Association, he has raised the bar by imbibing a lot of new programs, new projects, and thereby growing the association to a new life. I am indeed honored and proud to be a friend and colleague of this great personality. The topic of my oration today is Illuminate Your Being. I bring you greetings from the hospital where I work. We have a DNB program there. Human life is challenging, you will agree with me. We have to overcome a lot of challenges. Every day is a different day with different challenges. But if you believe, challenge is an opportunity and a blessing indirectly, we can learn lessons from it and make the world a beautiful place to live in. A group of students were asked to list what they thought were the present seven wonders of the world. Though there were some disagreements, following received the most votes. Egypt's great pyramids, Taj Mahal, Grand Canyon, Panama Canal, Empire State Building, St. Peter's Basilica, and China's Great Wall. But while gathering the votes, the teacher noticed that one student had not finished the paper exam. So she asked the girl if she was having trouble with her list. The girl replied, "Yes, a little. I couldn't make out my mind because there were so many." The teacher said, "Well, tell us what you have and maybe we can help you." The girl hesitated and then read, "I think the seven wonders of the world are." To see, imagine there are 40 million blind people globally. What they miss seeing the beauty of nature. Second, to hear 80 million globally deaf people and 30 of them are in India, the intricate system of hearing, we as medical students would not have been able to auscultate and hear the love of the heart. Third, to touch. We often, after hearing the patient's symptoms, we are told in medical sciences to inspect, to see. And then comes the palpation, the feeling of touch. Imagine, you never had these sensations. You would have been having Charcot joints all the way, having ulcers all the way, having deformed joints all the way. And if you get time, please read the book, The Gift of Pain by Paul Bunnell. The famous missionary hand surgeon, plastic surgeon, from Canada who worked for 40 years in Christian Medical College, Vancouver. And he used to go in the night, and whenever there was a leprosy patient who died, they used to dissect those nerves and find out the cause, the pathology in it. To test is very important. To feel is so very important, the emotion. And with that, the laughter, to make our life, as we say, laughter is the best medicine. And finally, the seventh wonder is to laugh. And if there was no laugh, all of us would not have been here. The room was so quiet, you could have heard a pin drop. The things that we overlook as simple and ordinary, and that we take for granted, are truly wonders. That the most precious things in life cannot be built by hand or brought by man. Don't be too busy to pass it around. So life is a true miracle. With all these wonders. And medical profession gives us the medical healers, miracle makers. They are responsible to reconstruct, recreate the beauty and give back the patient all the wonders, which we as medical profession has the ability, the competence, the knowledge, and develop the skills to do it. And the joy that you get, the inner joy that you get when you complete that operation, when you complete and give back the patient the perfect function, can never match the lure of money. But we must follow our conscience. We have obligation to correctly form our conscience. And in forming our conscience, we must follow sound ethical principles. Conscience must always act according to moral law given by God. But no matter how much we try to follow the moral order, the temptations of the world distract us. According to me, the temptations are important. Why? They make us realize our strengths and weaknesses. Some people have perplexed conscience. A perplexed conscience is the one which doubts what one should do and what one is not able to solve the doubt, to remain in doubt and struggle to pursue the right conscience. Still others have erroneous conscience. An erroneous conscience is the one which is not in keeping with the object of norm or morality. One can get trapped with the erroneous ways and show the tendency to go with the majority, which we call herd mentality, which may not be always right. A true conscience is in conformity with the objective norm of morality. And in conforming with the objective of morality, I, as the president of Bombay Orthopedic Society in the history of orthopedics, had this ethics forum where we discussed about the ethical challenges, the controversies, the problems that arise, the issues that face us. And this is printed in this booklet, which form the guidelines to help you guide when faced with confusion, controversial and challenging issues. So in making moral decision, we must always seek what is right and good and discern the will of God expressed in divine law. And how do you discern and make the right moral decision? By the study of life ethics, which is necessary to guide our conscience to make the right moral decision. A firm conscience is aware of the right moral principles and able to grasp the moral values and pursue them in a given situation, so that that decision you can take in guiding the patient in the right ethical path. My young doctors always looked upon and will be looked upon as a role model. And therefore, you must be the clear image that patients have you in their mind. Often people take you next to God and expect you to follow ethical guidelines. Because for you, He is a wounded healer. He is a miracle worker. For the patient, you are a miracle worker. Patients often bless you with uttering the words, "Doc, you are blessed with healing hands." When patient says that to me, I get tremendous boost to my confidence. And these words sound as an echo in my ears and my heart. And I thank the Almighty for giving me this healing touch. When Ram asked me to give this oration, I was wondering what topic I will talk about. So I was discussing this with my wife, because Ram always tells you that whenever there's a problem, you must discuss with your better half and she will be the best guide. And so my wife helped me and said, we must talk about the Hippocratic Oath, because Hippocratic Oath, or pledge, that time was making the media headlines. And as you see in the pictures in the slide, that at every office you must take the oath, as a president, as a prime minister, or as medical students, or that matter in any office, the code of ethics. So when this Hippocratic pledge was going on in the media, about 250,000 people, doctors, were interviewed telephonically. And they included all specialties and sub-specialties to know about their impression about the Hippocratic Oath. They also included hospital administrators, community medicine people, anatomy professors, physiology professors, pathology professors, pharmacology professors, blood bank officers, and also allergologists. And according to them, the first pledge was the health and well-being of my patient would be the foremost consideration. Young teenagers coming to me for an opinion regarding an orthopedic problem or a sports medicine problem, I often ask them, who sent you here? Is it your parent? They say no. Is it your friend? They say no. Is it your neighbor? They said no. And who? Said, my grandfather. It's surprising, because I feel their grandfather was so happy with the treatment that you gave. He felt safe and secure and had a successful treatment in my hands, and thereby guided his grandchildren. Second, the Hebrew, I will respect the autonomy and dignity of my patient. This is very important. As you see here, in our own pledge that we have on the symbol, Non sibi sed omnes. Not for self, but for all. And how will I really tell you about the respect or honor and dignity of my patient is on this story. The Yankee surgeon had done a beautiful case of otitis media. Everything went well, and when he went back to see the patient had a facial nerve palsy. So the ENT surgeon told him, well, you get better and better, don't worry, it happens. You will be okay in a month's time, 2 months' time, maximum 3 months' time. But 3 months' time passed, 6 months' time passed, no recovery. So everybody gets jittery when you have problems arising from medical situations, and then you start taking second opinion. And when second opinions came, the senior one will down the junior one and alike, and junior one will say something else about the senior surgeon, and finally the patient sued the doctor. When it came to the consumer court, the court told the operating surgeon, you have done everything right and told the patient about the problems, but did not take written informed consent, and was fined 50 lakhs. I will maintain the utmost respect for every human being. Must remember that patient comes to you, they have not anxiety about their problems. Anxiety that they will get better or become worse, will be back to normal or not, and with this problem they are disturbed. There was a real story of a patient who went on an ambulance because he was having respiratory problems to a nursing home, and the doctor was so busy that he did not come out of his room and just told the patient to go to another hospital. And it so happened that this patient was forced to go on the ambulance, and on the way the patient died before reaching the other hospital. After some time, that patient relative sued the doctor. Why they sued the doctor? Because he did not give first aid. You as a doctor is important at least to give first aid to the patient that is expected from you. And if you don't do that, you're neglecting the patient. I will respect the secrets that are confided in me even after the patient has died. There's a very real story about this, about the confidentiality that happened to a patient whom I know very well. This was an elderly lady who was staying alone because her husband had died, and all the children were abroad, various corners of the world. There were 7 children. So one day, the old lady slipped and fell and broke her hip and hand, and was lying, could not move in the house. And the neighbors saw accumulation of milk bottles outside the door and newspapers. And they started wondering what happened. They were knocking on the door, no response. So they called the policeman and they broke open the door, and they found the lady semi-conscious, and they took her to the corporate hospital where they put up in the ICU and started the works, respirator, IV fluids, medication. So with the news going to the kings of the patient. They came one by one. The doctors tried to do their best. One week passed, second week passed, third week passed. No improvement in the health of the patient. So the children started getting jittery because they had families to look after, work to go to. And they started having meetings among themselves. They tell the doctor, please take off the respirator, ventilator, and let her die. But doctor had hopes that she will survive. The fifth week came, the sixth week came, and suddenly after 6 weeks she started showing signs of improvement. And she improved, but the eighth week was operated on the 10th week and went home by the 16th week. Why do you think the doctor did not take off the respirator, ventilator? When the relatives are telling, because anybody, the patient had told the intensivists, do all the very best to get me alive. Don't leave anything out. And that's why he did all the very best and got the patient. I will not permit consideration of age, disease or disability, creed, ethnic origin, gender, nationality, political affiliation, sexual orientation, social standing, no matter. Patient, when it comes to you, a doctor just should look in the eyes of the patient, his helplessness, and be a beacon of hope. You must practice my profession with conscience and dignity in accordance with good medical practice. Now what do you mean by this? I'll tell you a story that happened to me. I had a 90-year-old patient who had this fracture. And I talked to the patient and I did a beautiful operation, long PFN. Everything was alright, patient was about to go home, she suddenly slipped, and this was the X-ray, the pin got cut out. Patients were disappointed, but I tried to counsel them and told them we need to operate her. Change the implant, and I did the bipolar, the nail. Patient was okay, went home, walking, but then slipped again and had a dislocation. I tried to reduce this and she came back. It got reduced. She went home. Again had a redislocation. So, the colleague of mine, I did this operation after considering considerable counseling of the patient's relative because they were just devastated because being 90 years old, whether she is going to leave or not, were they all there in their mind. I did the operation, the constant liner, the help of colleague. But to keep in good medical practice, I did not charge the patient and pay the fees of the consultant. I will foster the honor and noble traditions of medical profession. This, again another story which happens to me. I had this child of 6 years come to me, an athletic child, fell down by playing football. He went to the doctor, a very big practitioner, reputed practitioner. He said, there's nothing, don't worry, there's no fracture. I just put this plaster slab, we go home, come back after 6 weeks. He came back after 6 weeks and he removed the plaster slab and said, go home, everything is fine. So this went on for nearly 6 weeks, and then patient was not getting better, so he came back to me. Somebody told them to come to me, and this what was the fracture that got missed. Why was it missed? Because in a fashion injuries, it's very difficult sometimes to make out the fracture is there or not. So you must take in pediatric patient x-ray of the opposite side and then try to compare where the fracture is. So when I told the patient he has a fracture, patient was relative father was very angry and he wanted to sue the doctor. He said, this is mere negligence on the part of the first doctor. I must sue him. So what is your opinion, doctor? I just took a deep breath. And I said, my dear fellow, one can miss these injuries, and I must have missed quite many times. Is it? And he was frightened, and all his anger came down. As soon as the patient and his relative went away, I rang up the doctor and told him, well, you missed something, they were angry, they wanted to sue you. I told them this, so be careful. I will give my teachers, colleagues, students the respect, gratitude that is there. You know, very often when patients come from other hospital operated, the x-rays are put up and invariably there is a showmanship. You have a resident, oh, this is done so badly right in front of the patient. So you must not discuss that problem in front of the patient. You take your colleagues, your residents away once the patient is gone and then discuss separately, closely what went wrong. Sometimes, as I said earlier, junior doctors talk ill about the senior doctors and vice versa, senior doctors about the junior doctors, not respecting diagnosis and their care. And it happened to me that I had operated this fracture humerus of a well-known ophthalmologist who had a radial nerve palsy. And as an ophthalmologist, your hands are so important for you. I was very sure of my fixation, but 3 weeks passed, 6 weeks passed, the nerve did not recover. 3 months passed, no recovery. 5 months passed, no recovery. Then the rounds of Bombay doctors came in. And that's every time he went to a senior consultant, they would look at the x-ray and just do this. Say, who has done this? So badly done. It has to be redone. So like this went on, and he went and took appointment of the topmost doctor, and he was supposed to operate him, but luck would have it, somebody died in his family and he could not operate for 6 weeks. Period of mourning. And guess what happened? The nerve recovered and the x-ray showed the fracture united. And that was the x-ray. It's important as a medical, you should share your medical knowledge for the benefit of the patient and the advancement of the healthcare. cooperating together in a difficult case is very important. To share the knowledge is very important. But the patient must be well informed about the complications. The consent must be taken regarding the fees. And when there are two surgeons involved, all the more. So all this must not forget our own health, our own well-being, because if we have that, then we are able to take care of the patient to the highest standard. We must not use our medical knowledge to violate human rights and liberties under any threat, and we must make these promises solemnly, freely, on our honor. So I come back to the interview. I know there are students here, there are not many people who have had taken the oath. I don't know whether this custom is still there or not. Did you all know much about the oath? Any hands up? How many felt that taking the oath like this will help? Good, some hands are coming up. How many did not want it and found it irrelevant at our times? So what came out of all the discussion of the interview was the doctor-patient relationship. This is of utmost importance. The doctor, colleague and student relationship is very important. The compassion is very important, but not the bonds. The communicating skills have to be improved. And need of putting spirituality, Brahma Vidya, in our interactions, communications, care of the patient. Also, what was more discussed was the preventive aspect. We only oftentimes talk about the cure, we never much talk about the prevention. The safety of our fraternity is also very important. Nowadays, a lot of abuses because of trust deficit between patient and doctors. The basic ethics and attitudes of the patient and relatives are changing in critical situations. Because times have changed, although the doctor is the first person to bring the patient in the world, maintain his health all throughout, and the last person to send him back to the Almighty, certifying his death, yet we see more and more violence against him. One must discuss payment of professional fees and never ever say, no cure, no payment. It's unethical. And there was a famous case of a gynecologist of Mumbai who wrote this on his website that if you don't get the cure, don't pay me, and he was sued. And the medical council took him off for 1 year. Friends, God has just given us one life. Gives you life as a gift. What you make of it is our gift to God. So if we'll ask, God will ask us one thing. What do you do? The practice of medicine is rooted in covenant of trust among patients, physicians and society. The physician is obligated to be a healer and a professional. This role is built on expertise, ethics and service. A physician must have inherent love for human beings and human being at large. And in this story of selfless love, not expecting anything, I was interacting with an elderly patient the other day. The lady told me I was at a conference and there was the story of a patient and her relatives. The doctor asked the patient relatives, how much you love that patient? He said, we love her. He said, my prescription for you is to love her even more. And you often, when you practice later on, you will see this when you show more and more love to the patient, how they recover, how they long to see you in your rounds. It's not easy to do this in practical times. There's a lot of sacrifice involved in this. There's a lot of abnegation involved in this. And one can do this through the grace. The grace of the Almighty. The grace of the Almighty helps you to forgive people whom you hurt. Because grace opens the paths from the Almighty to you and from you to man. And with this, I would like to end this oration with the amazing grace song which was sent by President Obama.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I was once lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see.
We come to the end of the first oration.